To finish up, you remember that I mentioned at the beginning one of the other ways that, FA can make people be different. And I think there's quite a few people in this room who know that once your family has received a diagnosis of FA, everything is different after that. It changes your family, it changes how you live and your expectations. So to talk about that, I'd like to welcome Rutger Boerema. Come forward with that. So Rutger, we talked before about there was a time when FA wasn't a part of your life, right?
Yes, definitely. I never heard of FA before 2013.
And how was your family then, before you'd heard of FA?
Just a regular family, two kids, both working, never going to the doctor. and that all changed.
Yeah, what happened?
So we moved in to New York City, to Manhattan, in the summer of 2012. Dylan just started going to school in September. He didn't speak English. And then we had Storm Sandy, Hurricane Sandy, in the end of October. So the schools were closed. Dylan had his first day. So I was happy with that because we were in an apartment, stuck in an apartment. And so he had his first payday. He knew a few words in English, policeman. For example, yeah, so one of his first words.
Policeman is the first word you
learned.
That
was one of his first words. Yes. So he went to the park for his payday, and he didn't want to go running. He was like, you know, I could motivate him after a while, and he was always very busy, a pretty wild toddler. So we always had to run after him. And then he didn't want to go running. He didn't want to play, and that was very odd. So on Wednesday, he didn't want to go outside, so we went to the doctor. He was on the couch, and he said, "Mom, you know, I'm good here." So we went to the doctor. There's nothing wrong with him, probably an iron deficiency, she was thinking. Nothing to worry about. And we ended up two times more at the pediatrician's office. So on Saturday afternoon, we were thinking, well, maybe it's a bacterial infection. Maybe we should go again. So we went again. They did a blood draw, and she called up back an hour later to say that she had never seen such large red blood cells. And she said, you know, you have to see a hematologist. You have to call the hospital, and you have to make an appointment.
Were you worried about that?
No, I was, you know, it can be anything. So I did start Googling, so it could be like something very simple, like a lack of vitamin B12. So I'm always pretty optimistic, so I was thinking maybe it's something simple. And we have a thyroid problem in the family, so I was thinking that was also on the list, that could also be it. So I made an appointment at Wauw-Connell, so we're very close to the hospital. And then our regular pediatrician and the weekend pediatrician, they didn't agree. So the weekend pediatrician, she called me back on the first day to verify when I had made an appointment with the hematologist, which I'd done. But I canceled it again because the regular pediatrician said, you know, you don't have to worry, you don't have to make an appointment. So anyway. So because the weekend doctor called back, I was thinking, you know, if someone is calling me back to verify, it must be really serious. So I went to the hematologist, and they took a very step-by-step approach. And it was not a lack of vitamin B12, it was not his thyroid, it was not MES, luckily, but it was FA. So, yeah.
So you remember getting the diagnosis?
Yeah, so we got a diagnosis on January 4th, 2013, on a Friday afternoon. My husband was asking, "Oh, do you have to come?" I said, "No, you don't have to come. This will be our last appointment. There's nothing wrong." They emphasized many times to me that there is, you know, the chance is really low that there is something wrong. So, and they didn't want to tell us before Christmas either. So I was thinking, you know, we'll all be good. So I came into the room, and there were three doctors, and Dr. Mulak was one of them. So he had come over from Memorial Sloan Kettering, and you know, then I got the diagnosis. So Dr. Mulak started talking about Fanconi anemia. It was not Fanconi syndrome, and one of my first questions was like, okay, Dylan has Fanconi anemia. Can my daughter also have it? I was hoping only boys could get it, but that was John could also get it. So we had to go back to the doctor a couple of days later to get John tested.
Let's just meet the kids. Pretty cute.
This is before their diagnosis.
And those of you who know their dad know that you've been cloning.
Right. It's one of my hobbies,
So your first thought was about your daughter. How did that proceed?
So her blood got tested and her MCD was 86. So that's kind of the maximum, but it's still normal. And that was kind of already like, but I was thinking, no, it cannot be true. That must be, you know, we only did one test and maybe it's a wrong test. But we heard 2 weeks later that she also had Fanconi anemia.
So that was a big change in your life, a big change in your family?
That was a big change. You really cannot comprehend what Fanconi anemia is. The first thing you learn about bone marrow transplant, you think, you know, that's the worst thing. But Fanconi is so much. When you read about Fanconi anemia, you read it can affect all parts of the body. You know, what does that mean? In the beginning, you really have no idea what it means, and I'm still learning, but I really understand better now that it can impact all parts of the body, also, especially in later life.
So there, right there at the beginning, were you afraid?
I was, you know, bone marrow, I've never really heard of it. So I was afraid that he might die, and I had a book, so they had a copy of a book for us, a book Dylan and David Frommeyer had written in 2000. So I think they copied the first 50 pages. That was not a good read. things have improved. especially you have no idea what it is to go through bone marrow transplant. And it was very abstract. I didn't really have a feeling, because I also read about the life expectancy, because it was low. And my husband and I went out for a meal, and I was thinking, yeah, maybe in 25 years we don't have kids anymore. Maybe they're dead. So I thought that was really hard to deal with.
Yeah. Tell us how things moved forward with Dylan.
So Dylan, his counts weren't good, and they went down very quickly. So when he was 7, he needed to have damsel, he needed to have steroids. That helped for a year, but there was not a long-lasting thing. So I was in the hospital every week, so I'd never seen doctors, and suddenly he was always in the hospital. So we were living from blood count to blood count, and hoping for not having a transfusion. He didn't need many transfusions. Every time it was like his hemoglobin was always a problem. And then he's 7.5, and it's like, yes.
So you were hearing that he was likely to need a bone marrow transplant, and mm-hmm. likely to need a bone marrow donor, so you took matters in your own hands.
Yeah, so when I got the results on January 4th, Dr. Mulak was saying some families were doing IVF and PGD, and I was thinking, well, I know what IVF is, but, you know, I'll figure out the PGD. So that's what I started doing right away, and I was thinking, my first response was like, I want to have a healthy child who could also maybe be blood, and they did target testing, and they found the mutation within 4 weeks, which was really fortunate.
And time moved on, and Ryan joined your family, right?
Yes, and then Ryan came, yeah. So I did four IVF attempts. And so you have a chance of 1 in 4, but for us it was like nearly 100%. It was like Fanconi, Fanconi, Fanconi. And but Ryan was there. He was a perfect match. He's a match for both Dylan and Joy. So when he already donated to Dylan. Yeah.
Right. So Dylan had his transplant.
Yeah.
And there he is with a mound of Lego.
Yes. Yeah.
Very good.
So his bone, Ryan's bone marrow saved him, but Lego also.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yeah.
The healing power of Lego.
Yeah.
And here's more pictures of the kids. So the course has been a little different for Joy, right?
Yeah. So if Dylan would not have had, if we wouldn't have discovered so early that Dylan had Fanconi anemia, we would not have known that Joy had anything. She has blood counts every 3 months. She has a bone marrow biopsy every year. And it's every time it's good. I'm always waiting for shoe to drop. Last year she had RTP, so she had normal platelets. They were over 200,000, and within a week they went to 26,000. And then I was thinking, okay, here we go again. But she recovered from it, and she has normal counts again. So fingers crossed for that.
And here's the three children, mm-hmm. right, all together. And Rutger, we talked about this, we talked about some of the more difficult questions, and one of the things that some people, usually people who have not got children who are ill, question the approach of having a child specifically for the purpose of being a donor. What's your views on that?
I just thought IVF and PGP, you know, that's a great opportunity. I was thinking, I'm only 39, you know, we are here in New York City, this is a chance we have to take. And I was thinking, even if it doesn't work out, because the numbers are not in favor, when you start with IVF, I thought it was really an opportunity. And I think having Ryan, having a healthy child in the family, he really normalized our family more. We were not only dealing with Fanconi the whole time, we just had normal baby stuff. I think we are very grateful that we had this chance. Yeah.
And one more difficult question. What are you afraid of for the children looking forward to their growing up?
So first we had like the bone marrow transplant fear. I still have the bone marrow transplant fear for Joy, because I've seen too many stories when you are in an ideal situation and you do everything right, and something happens during bone marrow transplant, and they do die. So that's still a fear. But for the long term, they're going to have cancer. That's going to happen unless a miracle happens. But Fanconi is very complicated. Having to go through all these doctors' appointments during their life. Always again going, they have to be tested, you wait for results, and waiting for results is very hard. I'm afraid of, like, they will have more the older they get, so I'm afraid of that, but also afraid of that they have to that they will have a lot of pain. Maybe that's not the case, but there's a high chance. I'm on Facebook, so I've seen all those stories. So we teach them to become independent, and hopefully they will think critically about their disease, and that they will able to find, to go to the right doctors. If they need a second opinion, that they will get it. That's the only thing we really can do as parents.
Thank you, Rutger. Thank you for sharing your story. Rutger Boerema. So I think our speakers have shown us what that means. So something to take with us over the next 3 days as we think about FA and how we move the field forward, because I think we know why it's important. Thank you, everybody.